Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the Magic Show, where we learn simple things to become smart and lazy. Once we become smart by concentrating on whatever we are learning here, we can remain lazy for the rest of our lives. Our basic mantra is knowing is not doing, doing is doing, and therefore practice, practice, and practice. Until you practice all that we are doing, you will not be able to remember much. Knowledge without action is zero. So basic tips of the session, for those who have been here before, you know, quickly we'll run through them. You will be on mute throughout the session. You can open chat window and ask contextual relevant questions in chat window only. In case I get disconnected, please wait. I will be back in a few minutes. In case you get disconnected, log on again and continue with the session. Click on speaker view on the top right instead of gallery view to get a proper view of the proceedings. As usual, we have at the end of the session, we have question of the day where a cash prize is to be won. Be sure to stay till the end. Our last week's winner, Mr. Rupesh Parab, give him a big hand. Congratulations, Rupesh, for winning the prize last time. We hope everybody participates and gets a great prize every week. And thank you for your continuous encouragement and support. For those who have not supported us so far, you can go to this link and find out how you can support us. Great. So, my name is Yazdi Tantra, and I will run through some magical stuff today in Google Sheets. Our topic for today is Google Sheets. Now, what is Google Sheets? It is mainly a spreadsheet. The spreadsheet history goes right from the time when we had the oldest spreadsheet. Anyone can tell me what was the oldest spreadsheet which you had seen when we started computing? Anyone can name the oldest spreadsheet? Lotus 1-2-3, VisiCalc. VisiCalc is the right answer. Mr. Owen is right. I think he is one of the older participants. So VisiCalc was one of the oldest. Then people graduated to Lotus 1-2-3. Lotus 1-2-3 was the mainstay of spreadsheets for a very, very long time. In fact, I learned computers just because of Lotus 1-2-3. Because it was a fascinating, fascinating product. And I spent the first few years of my computing only doing Lotus 1-2-3, using macros, doing programming within Lotus 1-2-3. And then, of course, we had Excel. And Excel, of course, was the mainstay because it was a Microsoft product. And being a Microsoft product, you know, it had its own beauty and its own charm. Now, before we proceed today, I want a quick poll. We just want to know what is our proficiency level in Excel and other stuff. So I'll just ask a quick poll. Can you see the poll on your screen, please? Click on what your level is. Quickly, we have 125 participants now. I want every one of you to vote and tell me what is your quick, quick, quick. You can choose multiple answers also, since you could be using Excel and Google Sheets also. Yes, so we have a large number of users coming up. I'll share with you the result of the poll. Just give me 2 minutes more. Most of the people have voted, about 100 people have voted out of 127. A few more, please. Yes, so we have a large number of people who are regular users of basic Excel. So that's a good sign. Very few people have never used Excel. Of course, Excel is one of the forerunners. There are some people who buy a computer only because they want to use Excel. And lots and lots of people are regular users of basic Excel. Advanced Excel, of course, not many people are users so far. The beauty of this is really great, that you don't need to know everything. Excel allows you, or any other program, allows you to be at your own level. So what you need, you can use, and what you don't need, you can just ignore. What we will see of Excel typically, or what regular users of basic Excel use, is typically about 5% of the power of Excel. So you can imagine what the power is. But since we are not getting into becoming computer wizards, we are just going to look at some basic functions of Google Sheets, and then we will graduate to a few more commands which will be interesting and which will be of use to us. Today we'll do the basics, and the next session we will do a little bit more on a few advanced commands of, no, the computation of poll votes is fast because, oh, not because of Google Sheets, but because of Zoom. Zoom has an inbuilt facility for conducting polls. So we conduct polls using Zoom, and it is instant. It is instant. So let us see, how do we get into Google Sheets? You know how we got into Google Docs? Any yes, yes, recording is on. Thank you for reminding me. And sorry, last time I did not record and a lot of you missed it. And a lot of people who did not attend missed it, and they were cursing me for it. But I am sorry, last time it was missed. So let's see how you get into a Google Sheet. How did we get into Google Docs? How did we get into Google Docs? Come on. I'm sure there are people who are repeat visitors here, with repeat participants. So you'll have to tell me. Not docs.google. Or was it docs.google? So here we can get into Sheets by just saying sheets.google.com. So this is the first way of getting into Sheets. You start with a blank sheet, or you have the option to use a template. Can you see various options are there? Either you start with a blank spreadsheet, or you can go and see any template. Now the template gallery is really huge. I just clicked on it. So you can start with a to-do list, you can start with a monthly budget, annual budget, you can start with a calendar, travel planner, wedding planner, financial statements, invoices. You can pick up any template and start using it straight away. You can change the text, you can change the images and start using the templates instantly. So you have various templates from the template gallery. So you can start using any of these templates, or you can just choose a blank sheet. So just now we are choosing a blank sheet, which looks very, very much like Excel. There are a few differences which we shall see presently, but this is how we get into what is the difference between Google Doc and Google Sheet. Google Doc is a word processor where you write letters and you write reports, etc., etc. Whereas a spreadsheet typically is where you start manipulating numbers. It's a huge table where you create relationships between various cells and create whatever reports you want to create out of. We'll see how we can go to this. So this is one way of getting into Sheets, by saying docs.sheets.google.com. That was the first way of getting in. What did we say? We said sheets.google.com. That was the first way. We got a blank sheet and we had a template. The other way of getting into a new sheet is sheets.new. And that's a very, very straightforward way of getting into a blank sheet. You know, we have to be lazy. So if I want to be lazy, I don't even want to go and see a blank sheet and see some templates and then come to a blank sheet. It is very, very simple. It is sheets.new. So that is the second way of getting into Google Sheets. The third way is, if you are already in your Google Drive, remember the Google Drive session that we had? If you are already in Google Drive, you can click here new and say Google Sheets. And you have both the options. You can create a blank spreadsheet or you can create a spreadsheet from a template. So that is also very simple. You have a blank spreadsheet or you create a sheet from a template. That is the third way. And of course, the fourth way of getting into it is, if you are in Gmail or if you are in any Google app, you can just click on Google Apps on the top right, just near your name, your account. You have a 9-dot image. You just click on that and say Google Sheets. Can you see Sheets here? Yes. So you just click on Sheets and you come to the same place. You start with a blank sheet and you get into Google Sheets. So there are multiple ways of getting into Google Sheets. Okay. So it is up to you how you want to start with a Google Sheet. The minute you start with a Google Sheet, the same thing which we learned in Google Docs is immediately you need to name it. I'll tell you why you need to name it immediately. You just click here on the title. Normally it is called untitled. So you just say whatever you want to say, test sheet. That is, suppose you want to name it as test sheet. Now, if you notice, the minute you name it, it is saved to the drive, and in Google Sheets, just like in Google Docs, there is no option to save. Is there any option? I can't see any option to save. So there is no option to save. Why? Because Google Sheets saves itself automatically. Every time you make any change to the sheet, you can start from Firefox also. Yes, sure. Yes, we will answer all these questions. Microsoft Excel sheets to be copied to Google Spreadsheet. Yes. Can we start Firefox browser? Yes, we can start in Firefox browser also. Typically, why we use Chrome is Chrome has many, many more facilities than any other browser. About 80% of the world today uses Chrome, and therefore we don't have much of a choice. It's better to be with the market leader. And you have lots and lots of features in Chrome. We did one session on Chrome extensions, if you remember, a long time back. If you have not seen it, please go to my YouTube channel and you will be able to see the same video and learn how you can use extensions in Chrome. So the basic thing what we have to do is immediately you have to name the sheet, because there is no provision for saving. Automatically, if you go here, click here, it says all changes saved to Drive. So where does it reside? Ultimately, it will reside in your Google Drive. We started with Google Drive, if you remember this entire series. So all changes are automatically saved to Google Drive. And that is automatic. The minute you do, if you keep a watch here, if I do any change, if I put any figure here, it says saving and it will automatically save to the Drive. So you don't have to do any saving. It automatically saved to the Drive. Okay, so that is one thing. Yes, we will see about undo also. That is a very powerful thing. So this is the basic thing you can do is you can name the sheet. There is no need to save. Automatically everything gets saved on your Google Drive. I am assuming that you are logged into your Gmail account. I am assuming that you are logged into your Google account. So automatically your Google Drive is identified and it saves there. Now the basic question which comes again and again is, what happens to Excel files? Now, when you go to your Google Drive, can you see this test sheet that we just created? It was a blank sheet. It says you edited just now. It automatically comes here. So all your latest files keep coming here. Okay, now the question about Excel files. When you create any new file, we say Google Sheets and blank spreadsheet or from a template. That was how we started off. There is an option to upload files also. There is something called file upload. So whenever you have created an Excel file or any other spreadsheet file, you may be using OpenOffice. So you may be having an OpenOffice file also. Any file, OpenOffice sheet, that is ODT, that is the extension. For Excel, it is XLS or XLSX. So if you have any other format file and you upload it, there are two options. You can upload it directly as an Excel file, in which case you will be able to view the file, but you will not be able to work on it. But there is a small option here in Google Sheet, in Google Drive, in the settings on the top right. Can you see my cursor, please? On the top right, you have settings. You go to settings and there is an option in general which says convert uploads. So convert uploaded files to Google file editor format. What it does is whenever you upload an Excel file, it automatically converts it to a sheet format. That doesn't mean that you cannot upload an Excel file as it is. You can also upload an Excel file as it is, but remember, you cannot work on it. You can only view it. If you upload an Excel file, you can only view it. But when you convert automatically, I have put my setting as convert it to the Google editor format. When I do this, what happens is whenever I am uploading an Excel file, it automatically converts it into a Google Sheet format and it holds it there. We will see how to get it back into Excel also. But this is a very, very simple setting. Only once you have to go here to settings and say convert uploads. Once you do that, any file that you upload, whether it is a doc file that is in Word or it is a Excel file, which is an XLS. Now let us see if I have any Excel files out here. I'll search for spreadsheets. So all my spreadsheets are here. Now, if you see, this is an Excel file, X. This is a Google Sheet file. You see the icon here is different. Here the icon is different. So this is an Excel file. If I open this file, what happens is I'll be able to view it, but I will not be able to make any changes here. If I try to type anything, I'm not able to type. I can't format it, I can't type it. So then this option here is open with. When you say open with Google Sheets, it will immediately open it in the Google Sheets format, convert it, and now I can do whatever I want. I can make changes, I can delete, edit, whatever I want to do. So this is very simple. You must understand this. If you upload directly into directly an Excel file, it will hold it as an Excel file. It will not bother to change it. But if you have made this setting of converting it into a Google format, you can. Once you convert it into Google format, then you have this option when you go, suppose let us open this test sheet. If you have worked on it, you can just say file, download. And when you say download as Excel or open document format or PDF or whatever, CSV or tab separated or whatever. So you have all the options. So you can save it as an Excel file. When you say download as Excel means what? You are saving it as an Excel file. No, Excel file does not get deleted on conversion. What happens is the Excel file that you have on your hard disk remains as it is. It doesn't get deleted. But since you want to work on it in Google Sheets, it automatically gets converted and it is held in a Google Sheets format. And when you want to download it back into Excel format, you can just say download Excel and you will get it back in Excel format. It is very simple. So this is how you can upload an Excel sheet, automatically convert it, or even if you have not converted it, you can say open with, open it in the format in which you want it, and automatically you start working on a sheet. Now I have created, since we have less time, I have created a sample sheet which we will be working on. So what I have done is created this sample sheet so that it becomes easy to understand, and also it saves us time because we don't need to enter all this again and again. Okay, so what I have done is I have entered some regions, some names, and quarter one, quarter two, quarter three, quarter four performance. Maybe this is sales. Let us assume this is sales. And straight away, if you notice, I can enter text, I can enter values. I don't need to tell Google Sheets what I'm entering. Automatically, the values, it will understand. When I say Q1, it understands it is text. When I enter a figure, it understands it is a value. Now, there are two other things which you need to understand. Down below, you can have multiple sheets in a single workbook. So you have sheet 1, sheet 2, sheet 3. You can just say plus, add more. You can call it sheet 3. There is a reason why it happened, but, and it can go on and on. You can have almost 200 sheets in a single workbook. So you have multiple sheets. You can have detailed data in one sheet and you can have summaries in the other sheet. You can have reports in the top sheet, whichever way you want to look at it. And since here there is a limited horizontal space, you can say all sheets and you can look at all sheets, one below the other also here. That is number one. Number two is each of the sheets, you can give a color coding. So you can just right click on it and say change color, and you can choose from a variety of colors that you have, and automatically that particular color will be taken by that I can say change color to green, change color to red, whatever. You can have color coding so that you can go through and search your sheets automatically. Yes, VLOOKUP and SUMIF also work in Google Sheets, yes. So you have multiple sheets, you can name each sheet, you can say, I can double click this and I can say this is a summary sheet and this is the details sheets. Whatever you want to do, you can name the sheet, whatever. Make it brief so that it fits into this particular area, otherwise it can get a little unwieldy. In any spreadsheet, what you have is a cell is a unit. A cell is a combination of a row and a column. All these are rows, one, two. Can anybody tell me how many maximum rows are there in a sheet? In Excel? How many rows can you go down below? Anybody has any idea? 12,000? 10,000? 1.6 lakhs? Let us see. Only 800? Add 1,000 more. I'll say add 10,000 more. Add 100,000 more. So can you see how many cells are there? 50 lakh cells. 50 lakh cells means it's really, really huge. So for all practical purposes, for all our purposes, we can treat this as unlimited number of cells, because I am sure you are not going to, somebody is not able to hear. Can everybody else hear me, please? Yes, please check your speaker volume. You'll be able to listen properly. Or maybe you might need to log out and log in again. Maybe you can catch the sound properly. Okay? Okay. So, simple thing is, the columns are numbered A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, and here also it's unlimited, virtually unlimited. You can go on, and there is no end to it. In the rows also, there is no end to it. And a combination of a row and column becomes a cell. So this is cell A1. This is cell A10. This is cell D10, and so on. So every cell is numbered so that you know what you are referring to. Okay, so a combination of a row and a column is a cell. That is the basic unit of entry. And cells without relationships are of no meaning. So every cell, if you are building a nice spreadsheet, then you have to have relationships. So when you are entering some data here, there is a sale value of 500, 250, 750, 870. And then you want to take a total. So what happens is you can say, I am saying this is a sum of this plus this plus this plus this. Or I can simply say this is a sum of C3 to F3. C3 is this cell, C3, and this is F3. So C3 to F3 entirely is to be summed, and this is the total. And once you do this, this is very, very basic. Everybody knows this. Once you do this, and then you have this small box down below, you just drag it all the way down, and you can see that this is the sum of C3 to F3. This will be the sum of C4 to F4. If I just double click on this, it says sum of C4 to F4. So when you are copying a relationship. Again, remember, when you are copying a relationship. This is the sum of four cells before it. This is the sum of four cells before this. This is the sum of four cells before it, and so on. Similarly, when you come to the totals here, this is the sum of C3 to C12. So C3 to C12. So this is the sum of nine cells before it. This is the sum of nine cells before it, and so on. So this is very simple. You are talking of relationships where you are linking cells and performing some basic calculations. So sum is a very, very basic calculation. So what is the formula for a sum? You just say equal to sum, open bracket, and give the range. From here, shift, and then go up to where you want it to end. I want it to end up to here. Bracket is already closed, so I just press enter, and this is where how I get the sum. It's very, very simple. Similarly, if I want to work on the average, I can say equal to average. See, it also shows me a suggestion, average of C3 to C12. So I'll just pick this up. See, these lazy people, how they work, they don't work very hard. You just say equal to average D3 to D12. So I just click on it and I get the formula. I did not have to do anything. I can just click it here, drag it, and get all my averages also. So anyways, I'm not looking at averages just now. So I will just delete this. So sum, average, these are all very, very basic functions, and we can do it very easily. So you can have all your cross totals also. This is the total here. This is the total here. And then you can have a grand total out here. So this is very simple. Now we also saw that these are all related works. So now if I have a table like this, come to the right, interest rate is 12%, and I want to calculate interest on 50,000 for 3 years at 12%. So what is my formula? Just see my formula. I'll say M4, that is this cell 50,000 into N4 into N2. Okay, so into N2, if I do, what happens is I got a formula for the interest. That is the principal into number of years into the interest rate. Now, if I drag it down, what will happen? You're all haywire. So this is not what I expected. So what is this doing is, see, when you are dragging it down, there is a relationship which is copied. It is saying that you have to, when I'm saying, see this cell, M4 into N4 into N2. So this into this into this. So what it says, two cells before, one cell before, and two and a half cells above. So one cell left and two above. So here also it is copying the same formula, M5 into N5 into N3. But we don't want this to move. This interest rate is constant. So in the formula, what we do is to make this constant, we press F4. Now N2 is constant. So we say $N, $2, or you can even enter it for yourself. When you say $N, $2, what it means is that you are making this cell constant, because this is what you want to take into consideration. And then if you copy it, you will get all your formulas perfect, where what you are saying is this cell into this cell into this. Again, this cell into this cell into this. If you see here, N2 remains constant on the top. Otherwise, it keeps moving. This and this keep moving. Okay, so this is very, very simple. Okay, so whenever you are doing a relationship, here the relationship was linear. So here you said, okay, sum of these cells, here you want some of these cells, here you want some of these cells, but here this thing, here you are going on moving your this figure and this figure, but you don't want to move this figure, and therefore you want to make this constant, and therefore you say $n $2. Instead of saying n2, you will say $n $2, so making it constant. Okay, so now your formula is correct, because here also it is $n $2, here also it is $n $2, but here it keeps moving, m6 and n6. This is an M6, this is an N6. Here it will be M7 into N7, but $n $2 remains constant. Okay? So this is how you can make stuff constant. If you want to select an entire row or an entire column, you can just click on the row or column, then do whatever you want. You want to make everything bold, or you want to do formatting. I just said Control B for bold. I said Control B again to unbold it. Whatever the format you want to change, the or you can select a range of cells and say bold, italics, color, etc. These are the basic formatting options. The font you can select, the size you can select, bold, italics, color, background color. You can make this fancy. Sorry, what is the question? Why the formulas are not in black and white instead of color, which is not visible? Okay, the formulas, see, this is the interesting part. When I'm seeing the formulas, this is in orange, M5, and this is highlighted here. So I don't have to search for M5. I know immediately N5 is in purple. N2 is in green. So I know exactly which cell he is referring to. That becomes easy visually to see what the formula is. Otherwise, in Excel, normally you see the formula in the same color. So you don't know which cell you are referring to. So the formulas can straight away, when they are colored, you know exactly which cell you are referring to. Can we add a filter to the column? Of course, we can. Add a filter, we'll do all that. Don't worry. Just understand what I'm saying. After we finish, you can ask me all your questions, because we will be covering up basic filters and stuff like that also. So you can select a column, you can select a row. You can also do date and time manipulation. See, here we had said we can enter text and figures, but you can also enter date and time. Let us see. You can enter date in this format. 2nd July 20 is 2/7/20. So you can enter it straight away like this, 02/07/20 with a slash in between, 05/07/20 with a slash in between. So automatically it will understand that this is a date format. When you put a colon between, it will understand that it is a time format. So if you say 11:00 and 12:30, that means this is a time format. Now, the beauty of date and time is you can do calculations on date and time. So if 2nd to 5th, how many days are there? So you can say equal to 5th minus 2nd, and that is 3 days. Now, if you want to know what is the time difference between 11 and 12:30, so what you will do is, again, you will write the same formula, equal to 12:30 minus 11, 1.5 hours. Now see, this is a very, very difficult example. It is 10 o'clock in the night and 3 o'clock next morning. So will it understand this? Equal to 3 o'clock minus 10 o'clock. It is 5 hours. So date and time are very, very easy to manipulate. So when you have an array of dates, array of times, you can also manipulate it very, very easily. So date and time is also a way of handling. The other interesting thing, I'm not sure if you can do it in Excel, but sometimes if the formula is very large and it goes beyond, suppose you are writing a very long formula, you have this option. That is, if you bring the cursor here, you can drag this and make this pane very large. So you can enter a very, very long formula, a long function, and have it visible. Otherwise, typically what happens is, when you are having in Excel, if you are going beyond this, then you have to scroll here and it becomes very difficult to read it. The other thing in Excel is that you can freeze panes. So sometimes what you want to do is you have titles, and these titles, when you go down, these titles are not visible. Suppose this is about 1,000 people. Suppose this is only a small spreadsheet. There's 1,000 people and you go on scrolling down and you don't know which one is quarter one, which one is quarter two. So you have this option here, down here on the top left, you have a thick line where you can say, I want to give this as a title row. Now, if you go down, however much you go down, this title row will remain the same. In Excel, it is called freeze panes. If you remember Excel, it is called freeze panes. Similarly, on the left, you have this, you can drag it. And then if you go on scrolling to the left, this pane is frozen. You can go on and on and on. Yeah, it will not vanish. So freezing panes is simple. Yes, you can calculate the difference between different years also. If you want that detail, I will explain to you very briefly. What it does internally is it records each date as a number. So whether it is 2020 or you want to say it is 2002. So it says it is 6,578 days. And if you want to say number of months, you can just divide it by 30 or 365 and you get the number of months. You have to refine it a little. That is not a problem. Okay. Yeah, so once you get the number of days, you can convert it into the number of months. That is the idea. Undo feature is very simple. Control Z, undo, which is universal. You can undo it. That is not a problem. Now let us go a little ahead. You can also enter a series of cells. So for example, if you say you want to enter one, you have serial number one, two. Now, I am a lazy guy, so I will not write 1, 2, 3, 4 up to 10. So I'll just select both these, drag this corner, and voila. I can go any amount. If I want to say 2010, and then I want to go annually 2011. First two I have to enter so it knows what I'm looking for. 2010, 2011, and then I drag this. So when you are entering a series, you can enter it very, very easily. First two cells you have to enter, this is the idea that you can just take any two cells, drag it down, and it will fill up the remaining cells. It's as simple as that. Or if you have one date and you put the second date and then you drag it down, then automatically the third date, suppose you say 1st July 20 and 2nd July 20. Now what it will understand is all your dates are, yes, even for months of the year, you can do that. Okay, so dragging and filling is very simple. Now these two formulas we did, we said sum and we said average. If you remember, we said equal to sum and selected this area. Equal to average, we selected this area. We also have a third very commonly used formula and it is called equal to count. When you say count, means it will give you the number of cells that are there. So there are 10 cells here, so it will say 10. And in all cases, there will be only 10 cells. Obviously, because that is what we... So that is also very simple. Sum, average and count, these are three very, very simple formulas. Okay, now let us go and see, there is another function which is called the if function. Now listen carefully to this and it will be very interesting. Now there are certain things which you may say that, now here what I have said is, if G3, that is this, if the total sales, see the formula that I have said, if G3 is greater than 1900, that is if he has achieved a sale of more than 1900, I will say promote him. Else I will say you have to improve. Okay, so this is what the formula says. What is the formula? This is the condition. If G3 greater than 1900, you promote. Else you say improve. Now you see all the cells. Is this more than 1900? Total, promote. Is this more than 1900? Promote. It is not more than 1900. So what you will say? Improve. You will say improve. You will say promote. 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 Improve. Promote. Did you see this? So what I did is I gave a conditional formula. I said if this happens, so see the format, equal to if, open the bracket, give a condition. This is the condition that I am giving. Once I give the condition, I put a comma. Then if this is true, do this. And then a comma. If this is not true, do this. This is how an if function is written. So if something is true, do this. See, now on top it will show you, if this is true, promote. If this is not true, then improve. I could have said demote or whatever. So this is how an if formula is written, where you can say promote, I'm sorry, where you can say give a condition, give a result, and if this condition is found false, then give this result. Are we clear on this? Formula nomenclature is very simple. You start with an equal to sign, open bracket, and start your formula. Whatever the formula is, when you say sum, you say equal to sum. When you want average, you say equal to average. If you want to say count, you say equal to count. When you want to say if, you say if. And it gives you lots of hints. Returns value depending on logical expressions. So if something happens, do this. Else, do that. Okay? So what I'm saying is, again, if bracket open, G3 greater than 1900, comma. So this is the condition. If it is true, do this. Else, you do this. This is the very simple way of writing a formula. Okay. Now you can have multiple ifs also in a formula. Now see what this formula says. This formula says, if G3 is greater than 2000, then say great. If this is greater than 2000, say great. But now if this is not fulfilled, if this condition is not fulfilled, G3 is not greater than 2000, then I have got another if. This is called a nested if. So then it comes here. If it is greater than 2000, great. And that is the end of the story. But if it is not greater than 2000, then again I have put a condition. If E3 is greater than 700, that is if E3, that is this, is greater than 700, say good, else you say poor. So now I have got three options, great, good and poor. Can you see this? So this formula says, if G3 greater than 2000, great. So if it is greater than 2000, great. Nothing further to be done because this is true. But if it is not true, then it also checks whether E3 is greater than 700. If E3 is greater than 700, you say good, otherwise you say poor. So now, when will poor come? When E6 is not greater than 700, then poor is, this is not greater than 700, so it is poor. So this is less than 2000, so this condition is not fulfilled. And therefore, you go to the next if. If E6 is greater than 700, you say poor, good, else you say poor. So this is not greater than 700, but let us see if something is good. Yeah, this is good. So E5 is greater than 700, but this is not greater than 2000. And therefore you have a nested if. You have if within if, and you can go on and on in this, but you have to be very clear in what you want to achieve. So this is called a nested if. So if is a very simple formula. You say if, give a condition. If that condition is true, give a result. Else, give a alternative. Very simple to understand. Now, how do you make charts and graphs? We are doing very, very simple things, but they are very powerful. So suppose now I have got this performance of all these people. I select all this and I say I want to make a chart out of this. So I have this option, insert chart. Can you see this option here on the top? It says insert chart. Just click on it. And my chart is ready. I can move it around. I can put it anywhere else. It has already given some nomenclature, quarter one, quarter two, quarter three, quarter four. So quarter one is in blue, quarter two is in red, quarter three is in, and I have lots of options in charts. I just say, what is the type of chart I want? I want it horizontal, I want it vertical, I want a line chart like this, any type of chart. I want a line like this. Whichever type of chart I want, I can make the chart in one single click. I just selected the area. Are we clear on how we made the chart? Very simple. I'll delete the chart. I just selected the area for which I wanted to make a graph. I came here. I said insert chart. That's all that I did. Okay, once I say insert chart, the chart is ready and it is available to me. The beauty of this is, again, now suppose I just resize it and I make it this way so that I know. Now this guy has done, in yellow is quarter three, Hari Nimbalkar. He has done 990 in quarter three. Suppose I make it 1200. See, the chart has changed immediately. I didn't have to do anything. Absolutely instant. Okay. Now Harish Kadam has done 870 in quarter three. So Harish Kadam has 870, but I say he is also doing 1200 in quarter three. See, the chart moves up immediately. It is instant. It is absolutely very, very simple to make a chart. And the beauty of this is, if you remember, when we did Google Docs, we had selected a particular sheet and pasted it into a document. This also, you can paste it into a document. Let's say we'll create a new document. Now, what I'm doing is, I'm picking up this chart. I'm saying Control C, that is, I'm copying it and I'm pasting it here in the document. Sorry, Control C, and I'm saying Control V. When I'm pasting it, it asks me whether you want to link it to the spreadsheet or you want it to be unlinked. I said, link it to the spreadsheet and I will paste it here. Now the chart is part of my document. I can have some report or I can have something before this, after this, whatever. Now see the fun of it. I want Deepak Satpute also to be on 1200. So this guy has shot up to 1200. When I come to this document, it allows me to update. I say update, and now this fellow has also shot up to 1200. This is very, very powerful. You can link the sheets with any document. You can link the sheet with any other sheet also, and it is all instant. Are we clear on this? You can just copy and paste it wherever you want it. I just deleted the chart. So using chart is very, very simple and very powerful. Okay, then we are almost coming to the end of the time and we had a lot of things to be covered. Can we go for another 10-15 minutes if all are okay? Unless you are sleepy. Okay, so you're not lazy yet. Okay, great. Now, when you're doing charts and graphs, this is one way of doing a chart or a graph. This is very similar to what Excel also has. It has an insert chart option and you can straight away do it. But here, our friend Google Sheets, it allows you to do something very interesting. I'll just make this row a little bigger. Now what it does is, if you want a quick look at what is happening in each of these individual cases, so I can do something which they call as a spark line. So I'll say equal to spark line, open the bracket, and then I will select all these. See what it shows me? A quick understanding of how quarter one has moved. Right from Ajay Patil to Arif Shah, it has kept on going up and down. So it is not a very smooth curve. Or it could be here. Suppose I want to see between quarters how Ajay Patil has performed. So I can say equal to spark line, open brackets. Let's say from quarter one to quarter four. How has this guy performed? C3 to F3. Sorry, I put one more extra formula. Now, this same thing, I can copy it across and I can see how each person has performed. Visually, it is very easy to see. There are ups and downs. In this case, this fellow is moving up and up. In this case, this fellow is moving down, then moving up. This is very, very powerful. You can see it in one shot. What is happening? The graph, of course, gives you a much more detailed view, but Sparkline gives you an overview. Same thing here. I can just copy it here. So what is happening in each of the quarters, I can see here. What is happening to each of the people, I can see here. Okay, so this is very useful and very cool. I have not seen this in Excel. Has anybody seen this in Excel? I don't think this formula is there in Excel. So it is very difficult to say whether this same thing will come in Excel. You can try to save it in Excel and see what is the effect. I'm just deleting these formulas. So this is something very interesting, where you can see at a glance what is happening. Okay. Then of course you have in Excel and in Google Sheets, you have sort and filter. So you can say, you can select this entire data sheet. Okay. I'm not selecting the totals because the totals will be automatically calculated. So I can go to data. I can say sort the entire sheet by column A, A to Z or Z to A, or I can say sort a range. So when I say sort a range, it can allow me to sort any range. This is my column A straight away. So when I say column A, what happens? I selected this, go to data. This is sorting the entire sheet. So if it is a huge sheet, you can do this entire thing, or you can say sort a range. So I said sort by column A, A to Z. I say sort, and all Mumbai's have come together, Pune have come together. Or I can say data, sort range, column A, A to Z, add another sort column. Now within Bombay, I want it to be alphabetical. So I'll say column B is A to Z. Column B is this column. Now within Mumbai, it is alphabetical. Within Pune, it is alphabetical. I can just say control Z, control Z, control Z. And I come back to my origin. Okay. Similarly, filter, you can have conditional filter, etc., etc. I think we'll do filter next time. I want to run one very other interesting thing which I would like to share just now before we end. I'll just insert one column. Now, a lot of times we have, let us say, the time when you are wondering is some most of times in data entry there is some mistake. You see, somebody has put some additional spaces here and there, somebody has put some additional spaces in between, and it looks very shabby. You know, the sheet looks shabby because sometimes data entry is done in a hurry. So what this allows you to, I have another function called trim. So I'll say trim, open brackets, and this cell. Now see, the additional spaces are all gone. Now I'll just copy this formula. Everything is perfect. There are no extra spaces leading or, so this one also had extra spaces here. There is no extra space here. This one had before, there is no extra space before. There is some extra space here. Everything has become very, very simple. So we just said equal to trim, and you can trim the entire thing. And one last formula I would like to share. Now we go back to the original. I'll say control Z, control Z, control Z, control Z. All these mistakes I solved. Okay, I came back to this. Again, I am inserting one column. Now, this is something very, very useful. Equal to Google Translate. Listen to this carefully. Open the bracket and I select this particular cell. I'm sorry, I made a mistake. When I said Google Translate, I have to say comma from what language to what language. So from English, comma to Hindi. Can you see this? Now I just copy this formula all across and it will translate everything. Equal to Google Translate from English to Hindi. Now see, the entire font has changed. If you see Divyesh, it has written very nicely. I'll just expand it. Arif, Gurmeet Reddy, see how he has written Reddy, Nimbalkar, Kadam, Satpute, Shah, this is also very, very powerful. The formula is equal to Google Translate into bracket, which cell you want to translate, comma, from which language to which language. So from English is in inverted commas, to Hindi is in inverted commas. Okay. Now, this is not limited to only names. Now, suppose this is something which I want to translate. So what I'll say is equal to Google Translate, open bracket, which cell? This cell, comma, from which language? From English, comma, to which language? Hindi. Yeah, I have not tried Gujarati. Let us try Gujarati. So I will take the same cell and instead of Hindi, I will say Gujarati. So Jeev. Yes? Are you happy with Gujarati? So what the original says, this is an important spreadsheet and needs to be carefully examined. I ek mahatvapurna spreadsheet che ane kalji purvak tapas karvani jarur che. Fantastic. So Google Translate works beautifully. Okay. You can do it for a particular name. You can do it for a sentence. You can do it for whatever. Always remember, that Translate has its own limitations and it may be 80% accurate, but 80% accuracy is good enough because then it gives you a lot more flexibility to do something. Short form was GU. I did not know it. I just guessed that if Hindi was HI, then Gujarati would be GU. That's all. I did not know it. Somebody just asked me whether it is Gujarati. It is possible. Yes, Google Translate is also a free app available on Play Store. Google Translate is also used if you use a Google keyboard, Gboard on your mobile phone. Then Gboard also allows you to translate. There are so many, many more options. So I think we'll stop here for the time being because we have already overstepped more than an hour. And we will do some more functions and some more fun next time. We'll do some conditional formatting, sorting and filtering, etc., etc. If any of you have any specific suggestions for the next session and you want some specific queries, you can send me a WhatsApp. And I will not answer you on WhatsApp, but I will try to cover it in the next session. Yes, we will do data validation also. Yes, that is also on the agenda. If we get time, we will do some mail merge also. That is also something very interesting. Thank you very much. And I hope you enjoyed. Now I have to ask you the question of the day. Are you ready? No, all these functions are not available in Excel. Some of these are not available. Sparkline, I have not seen in Excel. Translate, I have not seen in Excel. Are you ready with your cursor in the chat box? I will ask you the question of the day and you have to answer. The person who answers first gets a prize of cash prize of 1,000 rupees. Okay, so are you ready? I want a yes. Okay, so now listen carefully to the question. And don't be in a hurry to answer. Listen carefully. The person who answers first, of course, gets the prize. So this is a question. Here it goes. Which is the Chrome extension which inserts a trailing double inverted commas or a bracket when you type in Chrome? So what I mean is, if you noticed, when I was typing here, when I put a double inverted comma, this, see, the first one and the second one automatically comes. I am not typing the second double inverted comma. Or suppose I have a bracket. Suppose I have open bracket. My close bracket automatically comes. Or I have a square bracket. The closed square bracket automatically comes. So which is the Chrome extension which inserts the trailing inverted commas or bracket when you type in Chrome? It automatically types this. Wherever I am in Chrome, not only in Google Sheets, even if I am typing a letter, I say compose, and I start with a quotation mark, this is fine. The closing quotation mark automatically comes, so I don't forget. Or when I start with a bracket, the closing bracket automatically comes. This is also fine. So I save one. Smart punctuation, I have not thought of that. I have not seen that. Auto prefixer, I have not come across that also. We have done this extension. If you have seen my earlier sessions, we have done this extension. Instant smart, I have not come across this extension, I'm sorry. I'm looking for something which we have already done in our sessions. So if you have seen any of our previous sessions, or if you have gone through our previous sessions, insert, no. This is a Chrome extension. This is slightly difficult as compared to the earlier easy stuff. And you can't find it in Grammarly, no. Not shift air. The question I'm repeating, which is the Chrome extension? Okay, I'll just type it in the text box. This is the question. Which is the Chrome extension which inserts trailing inverted commas or brackets when you type in Chrome? Sorry, nobody seems to have the answer. So this time the prize is not awarded. The answer is Pro Keys. If you have seen Pro Keys and the extension that we did, the correct answer is Pro Keys. If you install this extension, these inverted commas and trailing and the pre and post brackets automatically come. I'm sorry, so today there is no winner. Better luck next time. And we will continue this session next time. Okay? Thank you very much and wish you all the best. Take care. Good night and goodbye.